Well, hello everyone. This is Pastor Dawn with Mindset Mastery and Gaining the Master's Edge. I'm so excited to be with you here today. I hope you've been following the podcast. Last week we started episode one of a six-part series on destroying the spirit of fear. So if you haven't tuned in, make sure that you go to loveradionetwork.com. You just click on my name, Dawn Churchill. It will bring up some past episodes that I would highly recommend that you tune into. So I'm going to kind of just pick up where we left off last week. And so last week I gave you a brief description of how the spirit of fear can gain an entry gate into our lives, how it kind of sets up camp, and then how fear can start as really just this annoying habit, but eventually it can transform into a stubborn stronghold that is literally wired into every part of your mind, will, and emotions. So what really happens is that fear literally becomes a habitation, a dwelling place where we exist from day to day. Now, some of us only visit it on occasion, and some of us live in it daily, but Psalms 91, verse 1 says that whoever dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall rest under the shadow of the Almighty. So it says whoever dwells in the secret place. That means to set up a habitation. It means to recline and rest in the presence of God. And so what happens is that when we experience fearful moments in our life, if we're not able to resolve them and bring them to a conclusion, they just kind of stay stuck in us, so to speak, and they begin to affect our mind, our will, and emotions on a daily basis. So whether you've experienced many small occurrences with fear that just began piling up one on top of another, creating what can eventually feel like a mountain, or whether you've experienced one or two majorly traumatic events in life that may have scared the bejeebies out of you. But either way, whether it's tiny bits piling up or big gargantuan circumstances that rocked your world, fear can become a way of life for you. And I want to help you navigate through that, maybe learn some coping skills, but eventually what I really want you to learn is how to destroy and annihilate the spirit of fear. Because again, God means for us to dwell in His presence, and in His presence is fullness of joy, not fullness of fear. So fear can be something that's so deeply ingrained and rooted in your life that it can affect nearly almost every thought, imagination, word you speak, action you take, or even maybe actions that you avoid taking. It can take over your daytime focus and even your nighttime dreams. But I want to take you to a scripture, 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 4 and 5. And it says, "For the weapons of our warfare, they're not carnal, but they are mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations and everything that sets itself up against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought and making it obedient to Christ." I want to expound on that for just a second. So the first thing I want you to remember is, if you are a child of God, then the same spirit that rose Christ from the dead lives and dwells in you. That spirit is the dunamis power of the Holy Spirit. That power is literally what rose Christ's dead body and resurrected him to new life once again. That spirit is the spirit that enables is to the working of miracles. It is also that which gives breakthroughs. It is also that which destroys every single work of the enemy that the enemy has assigned against us. And so through that power, it is that mighty power of God that is active and living within us every single day, and it enables us to pull down strongholds and to cast down imaginations. Well, what does it mean to cast down an imagination? I'll give you an example. Let's say that you are driving your car and you're coming up to an intersection, and a thought that comes through your mind is, oh my gosh, I hope I don't hit that person who's about to go into the crosswalk. Well, if you truly believe that the same Spirit of God that rose Christ from the dead lives and dwells in you, then you know that not only that, but God has given his angels charge over you. You can immediately cast down that thought, cast down that mental image, and say, no, I live in the secret place of the Most High, and God is my refuge. Not only that, God has given his angels charge over me, not only to protect me, but to protect me from hitting somebody. Not only that, I have the mind of Christ, so I know that my reaction time, on my foot on the brake pad is going to bring me to a peaceful stop, and none of that is even possible of happening. I know that may sound like kind of an everyday example, but the things that you've experienced in life either enable you to go through that very quick process of eliminating that thought and casting down that imagination, or the circumstances of your life have caused so many different fearful thoughts to become strongholds in your life that you are then somewhat wired towards fear and anxiety. Okay, so 2 Timothy 1:7 says that God has not given us a spirit of fear, but one of power and of love and of a sound mind. And so before we get done today, I'm going to describe to you what a sound mind looks like. But for right now, I'm going to unpack a little bit of my past, one of my past traumatic moments with fear, and I'm going to explain how at one time fear had become a way of life for me, something that was so ingrained that it was literally rooted into every thought, imagination, worry, and word that I spoke for years. But first, let me explain to you psychologically how your brain and your mind work together, and this will be helpful for the illustration that I'm going to share with you. So first of all, I want you to know that there is a big difference between your brain and your mind. Your brain is basically a computer that sends information and electrical impulses to all the various organs and systems of your body. And although the brain and the mind do work in conjunction with one another, for today's example, I want you to consider them separate for the illustration I'm going to share with you, okay? So your mind is filled with thousands and thousands of files. It's kind of like a memory bank. And more than likely, there's more like millions and billions of files, not just thousands and thousands. But those files of memory, they are lodged into every memory bank that you have. Not just good memories, not just bad memories, but literally all the memories of your life. But in those files, in those memory files, are also attached the emotional responses that you experience in those moments in your life and the corresponding beliefs that you decided upon, that you agreed upon, or that you resolved within yourself as a result of that particular moment or moments in time. I want to repeat that last part again because this is a very important nugget for you in knowing how to become a mindset master, okay? So, not only do your memory files include the actual incidences, but they also include the emotional responses and the corresponding beliefs that you decided on or that you resolved within yourself as a result of that moment or circumstance in time. So it is as if all of these memory files and the concluding core beliefs, accompanied by whatever amount of fear or terror or just intimidation, all of those things combine create the habit of worrying that can turn into a lifelong battle with anxiety, fear, phobias, or even delusional disorders. And unfortunately, modern-day medicine and medications are only able to mask the symptoms and teach you how to cope with or manage the anxiety symptoms without ever teaching you how to destroy their power over your life. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you a brief example from when I was a little girl. And I'm completely healed from this, so I can share this with you, and there's no emotional attachment to it anymore. Praise God. But as a child, I endured many years of physical, verbal, and sexual abuse. I'm going to describe one incident, and I'm going to illustrate how that fearful moment turned into an anxiety disorder that, until God taught me how to be free from it, I was gripped by anxiety and fear most of my life. So when I was about 7 years old, one of my parents got very angry. That was typical for that particular parent. Yelled and cussed at me, beat me with a leather belt, and then locked me into my bedroom. And I cried and screamed for hours. No one came to let me out. It was the first significant silent treatment that I experienced, and it was a very traumatic moment for me. So condensing it into a nutshell, I was frightened by that particular parent's anger, more so because I never knew when that particular parent might explode into anger for any reason. I was hurt by the yelling and cursing, the spirit of rejection and criticism. I was panicked by the belt beating, not really knowing how long it would last or if it would happen again later on that evening. And of course, I felt abandoned by the long silent treatment of being locked in my room for several hours. Now, no, I don't want you to feel sorry for me. I'm good and I'm healed from it. Now, I honestly, at that point in time, I wasn't certain if anyone was going to come and get me or if I was going to die in my room from days of starvation. Now, that may sound like a dramatic or a delusional fear, but a little girl at 7 years old that has experienced this a couple of times, those were the fears that were running through my mind. Now, probably for many of you, this might be a bit much, but I would imagine that most of you have had a significant fearful moment in life. It could have been a car or a motorcycle accident, could have been a major surgery, could have been a swimming or a fishing accident, doesn't necessarily have to result from abuse. But regardless, that particular moment in my past opened the door for many types of fears. And I would imagine that some of the moments in your life have opened you up at least to a certain amount of fear in life. Most people have experienced it at one point or another. So in that moment, fear of parents, fear of punishment, fear of being locked in a small space. I eventually developed, that anxiety, hyperventilation thing if I was in a closed space. I don't any longer, praise God. Fear of criticism, fear of abuse, fear of someone's anger, fear of abandonment, fear of being alone, fear of dying. So as a child, if you don't have parents or teachers or counselors who are able to help you process through a fearful incident and truly bring it to resolution within your mind, will, and emotions, then you begin carrying around fearful files in your mind that begin to cloud your judgment and affect your thought life. And those things, repeated over time, create electrical responses in your brain and hormonal responses in your body that affect your central nervous system, your cortisol and adrenaline levels. They weaken your immune system, wreak havoc on your health, and they create an environment or a habitation space for the spirit of fear to basically plague your life the rest of your life. Now, as I said, many of us have not lived through such fearful moments, but all of us have experienced something in life that has caused us to live in worry or fear or doubt or what have you. So what I want to explain to you now is how at least that particular incident for me created many years of struggling with anxiety. But what I want you to do is I illustrate this for you. Before I go on, I want you to get in your mind's eye a significant moment in your life where you felt very afraid. And let's say, perhaps, that maybe for hours or days or even weeks or months later, that situation was still not resolved within you. It was still plaguing your thoughts, so to speak. Okay, so I've already described what happened to me on that particular day. So then what happens is a child, or can even be an adult, that experiences a significantly fearful moment, from that moment forward, if they don't know how to resolve it within themselves, they then become fearful of that same moment happening again. So if they had an accident where they fell down from a ladder, they might then develop a fear of heights or a fear of accidents. Or if they had a major surgery, and as the surgeons, maybe they had to restrain the patient for whatever reason, fear of restraints, fear of small spaces might cause them to be claustrophobic. You get the idea. Whatever you experienced in that moment, if you are not taught how to annihilate and destroy that particular fear, then you may become fearful or anxious or worried of the same type of thing happening again. And then that can open the door for a host of other types of fears. But the Bible says that God has not given us a spirit of fear, but He has given us a spirit of power and of love and of a sound mind. Now, the reality is, for me to walk you through the process of destroying fear, it is at least a five-part process, which I'm going to begin to unpack in our next week. Because next week, I'm just going to give you an example of fear or anxiety in your workspace, in anyone's career where they might experience these type of moments, and really how to unpack how to deal with those and not just manage the symptoms or cope with the moment, but literally destroy the fear that was attached to it so that that thing does not become something that runs on autopilot in the back of your mind, that is wired into your emotions, that then causes you to have certain physical and emotional responses that then affects your daily life and your choices. You see how it can have a snowball effect. Okay, so as I said, I had made reference to 2 Timothy 1:7, and this is where God says that God has not given us a spirit of fear. That is a spirit that causes us to cower, shrink back, make ourselves small, or believe in our heart that something or someone or a circumstance is bigger than us and has more power, control, and authority over us. But God has not given that to us. First of all, the Word of God says that He has given us a spirit of power. Now, that word power, again, is the word dunamis. It is from where we get the English word dynamite. So next week, I'm going to give you an example how you can experience a moment of fear or anxiety in the workplace that I'm certain just about everyone has experienced before. And I'm going to show you how, if you're not able to resolve that particular moment of fear or anxiety, it can begin to cloud your future thoughts, your future fears, your future doubts, your future emotional responses, as well as affecting your choices, the things that you actually do or say or engage in. And so mindset mastery, in my opinion, is nothing more than employing the Word of God in such a way that it is the Word of God that then masters or has control over all of our emotional and thought life and choices. So I had referenced 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7, where it says that God has not given us a spirit of fear, but a spirit of power and of love and of a sound mind. So I referenced the fact that God has not given us a spirit that would cause us to fear, to shrink, to cower away, to make ourselves small, or to believe in any way, shape, or form that any person or situation or thing or circumstance is bigger, more powerful than we are. The truth of the matter is, God's word says he's given us a spirit of power. That word power is the word dunamis, from which we get the English word dynamite. And that literally is referring to the explosiveness of the power of God that is resident within each and every one of us that are believers. Therefore, there is no circumstance that we should allow to become bigger in our minds than the Spirit of God that lives within us. That scripture says that God has given us a spirit of power and of love. Now, how does love associate with fear? The Bible says that perfect love casts out all fear. When you are rooted and grounded and established in your identity as a son or daughter of God, in whom God greatly delights, he delights over you. You are the apple of his eye. And because he is a good, good father, he protects you on all sides from harm or danger. But even if you should end up in a moment where it is slightly dangerous, his angels will protect you. And at the very least, he will strengthen you by his grace to endure that moment. And he will come in on the backside, pour out his spirit upon you, and heal and bring to resolution every single thing within you that is not in alignment with his work. And that is how God creates a sound mind within us. We begin to walk in the awareness of his power and his authority in us over every single circumstance in our life. We begin to walk in alignment with our identity as beloved sons and daughters of God who are filled with his dunamis power. And those things are with what creates soundness of mind. Those things bring us to the conclusion or the resolution that there is no weapon formed against us that shall prosper. There is no circumstance that is too big or too great that we cannot overcome by the blood of the Lamb. So next week, we're going to delve into this topic of simple anxieties or fears in the workplace, how you can resolve them within yourself, not just cope with the symptoms, but literally bring them to resolution so that fear no longer grips your life. I hope that you've enjoyed today's message. I hope that you've enjoyed today's episode. You can follow me on dawnchurchill.org, or you can visit my institute, which is dawnchurchillinstitute.teachable.com. Now, I am starting a 6-week mastermind next week on annihilating the spirit of fear. And if you would like information, please email me at dawnchurchillministries@gmail.com. Again, that is dawnchurchillministries@gmail.com. And I will look forward to seeing you next week on this radio network, loveradionetwork.com, as we gain the master's edge. See you next week.